republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, so let's call this special meeting to order. We're here, see, today because two trustees requested a special meeting so everybody can get latest information we have about the grant for the Parker Common. So everybody can be on the same page. As you know, it were awarded $325,000 to update and upgrade the Parker Common, both grants, and that include the eight sidewalks around the both parks, the eight crosswalks going inside the parks, refurbishing the two historic fountains, putting new lights, cleaning the we're going to have an arborist clean the trees, and some new plants, some new beautification a little bit. And what I'm thinking, of course, is not that we're going to make it into a garden, but we're just going to beautify it a little bit. So that's where we are. At this point, we needed an administrator because it's a lot of money and we have to know where it's spent and how we're going to get it back. And the good thing is that the county executive came forward and we have a county appointed administrator, so we don't have to pay for that amount. As I said, it's $325,000. No grant comes to cover 100% of the expense. And this is 25 to 75. So we pay 25, they pay 75. At this moment, we have to spend a minimum of $59,000 to use the money from the state. The maximum is 102. Now, from 59 to 102, we can have donations, we can have in-kind, which means if some of the work can be done by our street department, that's account as part of our money. If one of the a group of citizens want to come and help do something, again, it's in-kind help and it counts for something. So this is where we are. So Mr. Essek, yes, with this meeting, and this is where we are. Oh, I have to cover something very specific. I know that there was a problem during the summer about a fence. Well, through some bad luck and good luck, this is what happened. We asked for the fence, we put $50,000 for the whole fence. Well, we came to realize that $50,000 is not even close to enough to get a fence there. Actually, you can spend about $75,000 and put an aluminum fence, which, as everybody knows, we won't put around a historic Victorian park. So the fence as a fence is not there anymore. What is there, it's some entrances, like decorative entrances over the eight crosswalks going inside the park. That's it. So, questions?
Up to this point, I mean, the only thing we could go from was the original grant application. I understand the conversation tonight, but I'd like to have something in writing also to look at to see where we're at. My original question in the beginning was how I questioned and how this could possibly, even before I was trustee, how this could flourish economic development. I think that we need to address what we have currently going on. We have many businesses, the Brick Room, Subway, the White Inn, their restaurant, Pampered Pete's Pet Place, Herbs for Life, which is coincidentally going to Dunkirk to set up a business. We have seven empty storefronts on Main Street. I think we need to address the businesses that we have currently and have some kind of retaining process here. We need to be business friendly. We need to address our infrastructure. We need to address roads. We need to meet one-on-one with businesses and show them that we do care and are sincere. I think these are all things that we need to do.
I agree. The answer to all this. Okay. Well, this is what it is. Let's start with the economic development and why I think this is part of economic development. First of all, it's not me that I think so. This is after research in the state of New York. What we need to do, of course, is to support our businesses. That's absolutely right. And I want you to tell me after I finish, what kind of support are you thinking? Support is a very general word. So I'm all for support, but let's think exactly what we're thinking. This is my point of view. New businesses follow young families. Young families go to places, that's research, that's not me, go to places who are clean, green, beautified, safe, with good schools and something to do. These are the things that attract new young families. And we need new families, we need new people, because I am committed not to raise taxes. If you don't raise taxes, how are you going to pay for all the expenses? Well, you widen your base. You bring more people. Now, why these people are going to come? Because you're going to fix the park? When you want to sell your house, you beautify the backyard, the front yard. You paint the windows. You put maybe a new kitchen, some people do. You don't say, this is what I have, and come to me, because usually people are going to go to next door. So my idea is, this is a historic place. This is our jewel. We take care of it. To the point when people drive through, they're going to say, well, that's a nice place to stop and have a coffee. Or maybe a stop to stop and do some more than coffee. So as a first calling point, also because the state gives us 75% of the expense. And this is very important. This grant came out of the Economic Development Council grant. Only 12 in the state of Chautauqua were approved. We asked for the money, not to beautify it, we asked for the money specifically because we said this is going to bring new businesses. So they went with that. They believed that. They didn't believe it because they know me. They believed it because they looked into the situation and they thought it was a good investment. So when I'm doing this, this is the first step in going to the next one. As you know, as I said before, I talked about infrastructure. By August 1st, we're going to put an application in, two actually, one for the wastewater treatment plant. Millions of dollars we need to fix that. We're never going to find the money. We're never going to raise the money unless the state helps us. Okay, that's one. And the second, as I said before, we have colored water. There are areas in the village where the water is yellow. That's another grant. That's another application. August 1st, everything is going to be in. I'm hoping that we're going to get help from the state so we can progress. Let me tell you what's going to happen, and maybe all or maybe some don't believe that, but I spoke to Mr. Horrigan today again. If we return this money back, the state has spent money and they spent time. And they don't have to do that. We are 750 municipalities in the state of New York. They gave us money to do something. So now we are at the radar. And usually what they want to do is they want to finish big projects because they want to put their names next to big projects. Now we have the Lieutenant Governor. We have Kathy Young, our Senator. We have Andy Goodell, our Assemblyman. We have Mr. Horrigan, our County Executive. All of these people put their names and their signature saying that this is a good project for Fredonia. I'm very serious when I say they don't like their name next to something that was not successful. I won't be able to call again and say, please support me in the next project. Not only that, this is part of a regional expansion, regional effort. To apply for this, we discussed it with Mr. Mayor Rosas, Mr. Horrigan, and the president of the university. All of us together came with a plan as to how to promote the whole area, not only Fredonia, but the whole area. And we called it Central Connections. You know about that. Mm-hmm. Central Connections is Central Avenue. The idea is to bring people here because between the two communities, we have almost everything to offer. Up here, we have the history and the architecture and the university and the wineries and the beautiful bike rails that we can build. And then you go down to Dunkirk, and there is the waterfront. And there is another beautiful historic, what do you call it? Not firehouse, lighthouse. I'm sorry, I apologize. So we have that. The whole area together can flourish. This is the first step from here. If we stop this, we stop the whole effort. Believe me or not, this is a fact. So I think that with a minimum expense of $59,000 to have improvements in the park for $400,000, because what else are you going to do with the $59,000?
If it's a 25.
A quarter to 400? No, it's not 200.
At $57,000, the total would be 200 and some thousand, correct? If they're 25 and 75?
$450,000, a quarter is 100 and.
Okay, you said anywhere from 59 to.
59 is the absolute minimum that we have to pay in cash.
I guess my question, Mayor, at this point is I have no idea where it stands right now, even to make a decision on it. I mean, what I was just asking for a presentation was to find out what components you have in it at this point and what costs are associated with those. Because at this point, I have no idea where you stand with this.
I gave all the
requested as part of the Parks Department committee. There was two committee meetings for the parks held, and the last one you did not attend.
I wasn't able to.
And during that time, we did discuss some of the costs involved in it, and so you would have been familiar with it.
We would like to hear them, maybe. Could you bring them out, please?
Okay, yeah, it's right here.
I mean, yeah, the rest of the board has to make the decision on this, and we have no idea where it's at. It's not a committee. The board makes the decision on this.
I agree.
But
you say it was the you went with the committee there, and Doug wasn't on, but I wasn't on it, so I haven't heard changes.
This was a committee of the people the mayor requested people from the community to attend. And not a whole lot of people. She wanted two committees of 15 people, and only a handful of people were interested in showing up.
I know, but my question to you is who were the trustees? Not all the trustees were invited to those meetings.
No, because if we had three trustees, then we had an open meeting.
Well, this is a good time now to have the open meeting so we can hear. This is why. I agreed with Doug when he first brought it up, and I second it. I think the people need to be able to ask the questions that they may have, especially now since, because that may change, because I heard a lot of negativism when there was going to be the fence around, but now that we don't have the fencing, maybe there will be a change in how the people overall feel
about
the park.
So maybe I can explain the next steps. I'm supposed to submit a new budget, which means a little more, because the first budget was really, we sat down with Mr. Tiffany, and we thought, how much is this, how much is this? We put a very general budget together. Mm-hmm. Now, after that, I'm supposed to present them a more detailed, let's say. Not an exact, but a more detailed budget. So we sat down we had somebody coming and giving us some prices. That's how I know that the fence is not even a possibility. That with everything else, we're pretty much the same. Like, as I say, we put some getaway monuments, some like pillars as you go into the park, to give it a little definition. That's about $20,000 to $32,000. And then we do the landscaping, about $15,000, because we said we don't want to be a garden. We want to be, so we have some containers with some flowers, something that is not going to be, it's going to be easy to take care of, so we don't have a lot of pressure on our DPW at the same time. And then we need an arborist. That's about $15,000. We know this number to be correct. We need to do the perimeter sidewalks. This is an $80,000 project. Mm-hmm. Okay. So if you start from that, and some of the perimeter sidewalks are broken, as you know. Start from that. $59,000 are not going to give you half of the perimeter. $59,000 as part of the grant are going to give you eight.
Do all the sidewalks need to be replaced, though?
Yeah. Well,
they don't all need to be replaced. They really don't.
Okay. Maybe not all.
You can wait till they want to be replaced and then pay the full cost. I mean, if the village waited till the, you're going to end up paying the full cost of replacing.
Okay, I'm not here to argue costs. I just need to know where we stand actually right now. That's all my question was. And actually, the rest of the trustees need to know that too, to make a decision of where we stand on this right
Well,
now.
Yeah, well, I'm supposed to submit the budget. After the budget, they're going to send us a contract. And the contract is going to be discussed here, and you all going to have to sign for the contract. By the way, and I have to say that because I talked with Mr. Horrigan today, that if using this grant is going to affect negatively the whole county.
Nobody has said we're going to refuse it or affirm it as of this point. We just need to know the information.
Well, the information,
currently.
Doug, is that the community was approved this month. And there's a process to completing this approval, and you know what how much we have to contribute, and you know how much we were able to get, and the thing is that there's timelines with all this, and it's been delayed a long ways. There's been a lot of delay on this now. We should have been out to bid on this already, so the contractors could be involved, but there's been multiple. There's been the committee meetings and there's been public presentations. Typically, once those have all been done and you've been approved the contract, the village board takes care of everything from that point on, to continually going on processes, holding things that delay the process is counterproductive.
I really don't believe that we're going to do anything this year, because we had a deadline of March 1st to submit everything. Because of delays, we asked for an extension to May 1st. By May 1st, this means that we're not going to have any contracts. The contracts are going to come at the end of May. By the time, if we pass the contract, we're not going to find any contractors to come and do the work.
Me asking questions here has not delayed this process by any means. I have not been basically a part of this process to...
And nobody accuses you of that. Absolutely. I just want to ask...
And to be honest with you, this is the first actually public meeting?
No, this is the fifth.
Actual dedicated to this subject. This has been the...
This is the second special meeting. I had a meeting like this one, not so many people here, about two actually, when I had a PowerPoint presentation. That was July 7th.
I understand the PowerPoint was very good, but I think what I'd like to hear tonight, I would like to hear what the general population, that's what
okay,
the public
that's
forum, and that is
that's
what
right.
the
okay.
purpose of this meeting is and what we really need to do. So. I mean, and it's going to be helpful for us, too, because some of us aren't all, as Doug says, we're not all aware of what everything that has been in there. Because, as I said, I wasn't involved in the two meetings that had already been prior to that. So if you have some questions, now is the time to ask.
Mr. Giff.
So far, what I understand with the project, you're looking at replacing sidewalks. you're looking at beautification, recirculating pumps for the fountains, fixing up the fountains, cleaning up the fountains, and you're going to do all this on 25 cents on the dollar.
That's right.
Correct.
Correct.
To me, I don't know what the question is, and I'd like to know where each trustee stands on this, because to me, you're debating something that's been out in the open very clearly for a long period of time. You know, the fence was an issue. That fence issue is no longer here. Do we want a beautiful park or not? Do we want to pay 25 cents on the dollar to get that park, or do we want to slap the governor in the face and say, we're not going to take your money? And I'd like for each trustee to let me know what their thoughts are, whether they're in favor or not in favor, and why.
I'm absolutely in favor.
Thank you.
I'm in favor.
Thank you.
I'm not going to give you my answer right now, Steve. As a matter of fact, I could tell you what you told the people of Holmes Place. Put your question in writing and we'll get back to you. So I'll do that.
Okay. Phyllis?
First of all, I don't think it's a slap in the face to the governor. I have every right, as a member of the village, to just ask the questions. And the thing that I was concerned about, and I had been in the very beginning when we looked at it, and the project was originally, we were looking at it, when we were at the president's house, it was a $100,000 project with the village being a fourth of that, would have been a $25,000 thing to it. My concern was, and I was under the impression, if we submitted the things we wanted to do, and they accepted the grant, and we rewarded the grant, but then if we change it, so now by not having the fence in there, does that create an issue? Because they said if you don't do what it is and then they come in and look at it, we would have to...
Actually, I asked that question.
We would have to do the full amount of that, which is a $400,000 project. And I'm sorry, there's no way I could commit the village taxpayer to that kind of an expense when so many other things...
I wouldn't either.
So that was my question. By now taking out the fence, mm-hmm. that was originally the catalyst.
It was not a catalyst. It was not a catalyst to anybody except some people who didn't like it. From the beginning, I said it was not the most important thing for me as structural. That the point that we can put water in there, we don't have water. The point, the thing that we can put electricity in there, we don't have electricity in there. The thing that we can fix the sidewalks. These are my problems. The thing that we stopped the fountains last year because we're wasting water, that's unacceptable. These are the part for me. The fence for me, it was, they put it there, I accepted it, I see what, mm-hmm. but I called. And I said, you know what? The reason that we cannot do the fence is because it was totally, it's gonna be much more money than that. He said, as long as you spent out of the $325,000, 90% of this amount in beautifying the parks, they won't care.
And
if we spend less than that,
anything new to the park, it can be,
he said,
upgrading and maintenance.
I'm going to in the new budget, I'm going to submit that the fence is not part of the budget anymore, so they know that. So I'm going to say that. From that point, the only thing we have to do is really spend 90% of the money. If we spend less than that, then they become suspicious as to why we asked for so much money and then we didn't spend it. That's the thing. But in my new budget, I'm going to take away the fence from that.
At least most of the fence. The idea was to have a portion of fence by the pillars in order to...
But really a corner.
But not a fence, no, yeah. not a complete
a decorative
fence.
Corner.
A decorative corner.
Yeah, decorative corner. If we can afford something like that in a very, like a nice Victorian heavy thing, so it looks good.
And when you look at the drawings that I saw, is shrubbery going to be all along the perimeter?
That drawings would not have nothing to do with reality. We're going to have a new, because you have to go to bids for the company to do that.
The original drawings were just an artist's rendering of something that we could possibly do.
Yeah.
I don't believe that was the plan that had to be in place.
Well, that's what I'm
I think it was just suggestions.
What is
because I don't
exactly
want shrubbery all around.
Okay.
it's not only the festivals, if we need to put inside there, like heavy equipment to cut the, you know, to trim the mm-hmm. trees and all that, we cannot have the perimeter closed. So that's one. Okay. And also, when we were discussing it with the committee, I think Lori came up with an idea to, instead of using containers, like big, nice containers, instead of putting things on the ground, that's going to be much easier to take care, and they're going to allow much more open spaces there. So, yes?
I could just get a clarification. So sure. In order to get the grant, we need to spend 90%?
Of what money we will want. No, we're going to get the grant, but if we don't spend 90% and spend 50%, let's say, well, they're going to go and check why we asked for $450,000. They gave us $325,000 and we spent $150,000.
Right. So would the intent be then to spend to spend
90%? The intent is to spend at least 90%. Yes. Grant. And I can assure you we can spend 90% or 100%.
And then, but the village says that is responsible for 25%.
For 25%, yes.
Of that.
25% out of the 25, half of it has to be in actual cash by the village. That's why it's 59,000. And then the rest of it can be in donations, can be in kind. For example, there's an electrician who came to me and he said that he's going to donate his time to refurbish the fountains. So we're going to give him the materials, of course, and he's going to put his work there. There are many other ways that we can think to collect some money. For example, I was thinking up just on top of my head, we can have the benches, you know, $200 a bench, let's say, and we put the name of the person who gave $200, and the name is there for the rest of time. And we have about 30 benches, $200 each. That's a lot of money that we can go, that can go towards that. The amount of money that we need to put in there.
But some of those, I'd say three-fourths of those benches have already been donated
yes,
with the
and
names,
they have
on.
The names on them.
Okay, well, the rest of
okay.
that. And that was from the top of my head, you know. We can have the, I mean, the containers, let's say. One container costs, you know, $300. We can have that. It's just, as I said, just for
you know, this is the state is going to give us $100,000. Now, our money goes to Albany, but it's not a one-way stream. Money comes back to this community from Albany, but we have to know how to ask for it. This was a regional effort between the village, the city of Dunkirk, and the College of Fredonia. And it's exactly the kind of effort that many critics of small towns in Chautauqua County have brought out. Now, I believe we should accept the money, and I'd like to thank the County Executive, Horrigan, the State Senator, Kathy Young, and State Legislator, Andy Goodell, for their endorsement and support of the project. I believe that the grant will serve as a template for cooperation with the state in further much larger infrastructure projects. We've got million-dollar infrastructure projects coming
millions.
Up.
Yeah.
By accepting this grant, we can show the state that we are capable of handling a grant and getting the real big jobs done. We can argue whether this is really economic development or not. That's arguable, but it is certainly an infrastructure project. The village owns this park and is obliged to maintain it. That includes the fountains. That's my particular interest because, as you probably noticed, the East Fountain is tilted to the extent that the fountain doesn't drain water the way it was designed. Now that is included in the committee's preliminary budget. Along with the recirculating pump system and also to restore the basins of the fountain so they hold the designated 14 inches of water, which they have not held in several years, at least to my observation. Committee trustees and community members might also be interested in hearing other things that the committee talked about in terms of spending this money. An arborist would know how to trim the trees so that the grass would grow decently in the park instead of having muddy, swampy parkland. The corner border features are not an additional clutter to the park. I understand that the sentiment in this community for years has been not to overburden the park with any number of extraneous items. These are not items that intrude into the park. The grant provides for contributions of community members. People in this town can get together, donate in-kind services, their time, their material, as a community building effort. It shows that the village values its historic heritage and its identity as a small town. Getting back to the fountains, they were donated due to a wealthy person who felt that it was important for the park to have fountains in 1901, with the obligation that the community continue to maintain and restore them. This project is a maintenance and restoration project with a fairly minor component of enhancement. So again, I think that the trustees really have little reason to consider this as a waste of money or as a diversion from funds that could be better spent elsewhere. Thank you.
I agree with you. Well said.
Thank you. Dr. Twitchell, well said. I think that one of the points you made was to bring people in on, you know, to have involvement in it. That will give people an incentive to look at some of the storefronts and say, you know, maybe private investment would be a good thing. If we're going to do this great thing to the park, that might spur people on to do something about our storefronts.
And also we are preparing to put another initial application in for somebody to come and actually draw a plan for downtown as to how we want it to look, and then apply for some help for that when it's time to do it. Yes?
I just have to say, I have been working on Main Street in downtown for over 25 years in retail, not a service. I mean, the park service, right, but not right. Like a, you know, healthcare taxes or that sort of thing. And when you go to small towns and see retail storefronts, you know, to me, it's just, I don't understand why our town can't be like that, our village can't be like that. I have to say, though, when you're talking about your concern of places closing and leaving, there is absolutely no foot traffic in downtown Fredonia. My new shop, I've been there 8 years. I'm in a great visible spot. I fortunately have a lot of ways using technology and specific items I sell in my shop to draw niche traffic to my store. But I love being downtown, but truthfully, there is no foot traffic. And if you honestly can't begin to think that doing anything to upgrade the tiredness, the worn down look of our parks can do anything but to help possibly begin to bring people, it's one small step maybe towards turning things around. But people wonder why a shop opens up and just can't succeed. There really is no, I don't see it. I mean, every day I'm there. I've been there for over 25 years.
I understand.
Physically looking out my windows.
Yes, I do understand what you're saying.
And it's just not there. And I see so many people open and close. And you know, when Subway leaves, it's a numbers thing. Go talk to them. I've talked to them. Jim, you've talked to them. Mm-hmm. It's a total numbers thing. It's based on foot traffic. Mm-hmm. If I added a bit of foot traffic to what I do now, I would stay out. I'm going to be here forever. I love this. But quite honestly, if this sort of thing gets shot down, it makes me rethink, do I even want to have a business here? Because down the road, what's going to be accepted or even entertained in terms of creating a better environment for businesses like this? I mean, you can have a whole downtown full of you know, bars for the evening crowd, and you can have a whole downtown full of law firms and tax, but that's never going to change your foot traffic downtown that everybody hopes that we can get to. It just, you know, retail.
We need retail. That's it. I know. We need retail, and we have to take advantage of a very big thing that we have here. We have the university. We have 4,000 students, more than 4,000 students, but 4,000 students a year. That means 8,000 parents, at least. This is, we have a continuous, like people continuously are coming to our village. New people who never came here before. We have to show them our best face. You know, we have to, you know, when somebody new comes to your house, you put a good dress, you put a good suit on there, and you invite everybody inside your house. That's how I feel. Yes, Julie.
I would agree with what you said, but so many days I walk through these parks, and you could look out the window right now and find many branches and much trash. So if you are putting your best foot forward, it doesn't need to start with the money that's going to be invested. It needs to start today. it needed to start yesterday. So picking up the garbage and the limbs needs to be done like on a zone recovery every day at 7 in the morning. One of the DPW people would go out, just my idea, but they would be responsible for these parks. It isn't costing us any more. And to
no, actually
point,
it would, because actually it would. The reason I'm not clear is not that the people are lazy, they don't do it. We have a specific amount of people who can go out and do specific jobs. I would love for these parks to be much, much cleaner than they are.
How are they going to get cleaner if we put more money in there and we're not spending time to keep it up? We're just going to keep doing this.
No, no, that's not. Well, the whole point is not that you're doing that and then you're doing anything. You're doing that trying to bring more people, trying to open more businesses. More businesses are going to give us more money, more taxes. Instead of asking you and me and all of people here more money to contribute more, we have more people, we have more numbers. The numbers are bigger, so we have more money. That's how we're going to take care of it.
Okay. I read the entire grant, which probably most of the people in the room did not. It's been foiled, and I read the entire grant. It did not seem to me, and it is written, that it isn't going to create any jobs. And if it's going to create economic development, how do you not have jobs created?
Thank you for that. Can you give me your idea as to how to create jobs?
I would hire an economic developer.
How are you going to pay for the economic development? I would hire an economic development tonight.
$59,000 to $100,000+. Let's get somebody in here from Buffalo.
So you're going to have an economic development guy for the next year. Okay, because that's how much money is going to go. Actually, it's going to cost more than that. But let's say, and something else that people don't understand, it's not that we have this money in the budget. We're going to bond this money as a capital project. So we do not bond money to hire anybody. We bond money actually to do capital projects,
yes,
to fix these windows, not to hire a person to come and clean that comes from your taxes.
Right.
So this $59,000 actually cannot pay for anybody. You have to go to the...
All this money comes from our taxes, whether it comes from our state tax or our local tax.
But when you come, you sit down, I understand that, of course. And this grant comes for your from your taxes,
right,
too. And that's why I want it back. All our money, all our income taxes go to Albany.
Right.
I want some of this money back. And this is how you get it back. By saying, you know, I'm not going to get this money. Another community is going to get it. It's not like they're going to send a check back to anybody. Somebody else is going to get it. Some other community is going to look better. And we can sit here and discuss how we're going to hire an economic development guy who's going to tell you how to spend money to make money. The economic development guy is not going to come with a magic wand and a magic tree that is going to give us money. It's going to say, it's going to start putting things together, and it's going to tell you how and where to spend money to make money.
Could we start with picking up the parks? Could we start with getting rid of the weeds across the business district in the summer? These are inexpensive items that we could do.
Who's going to do it?
The DPW.
They're going to have to not do something else. Do you understand that we don't have enough people?
If it's a priority, it's the same as my home. If it's a priority, I will make time.
Okay, well, Doug is here. He's part of the in the committee for the DPW. By all means, you're responsible for this park from now on to be cleaned. Because, I mean, I have to put somebody responsible. This is a very good, you know.
They're not mutually exclusive. We can have a clean community and we can still have a grant and beautify our park.
I
agree with you.
This whole thing.
I took it upon myself to go downtown on three separate weekends with my family, with my gloves and with my plastic
and
bags, and picked up all of the cigarette butts and all of the broken glass and all of the trash. The Croxton saw me as I was out there with my kids shoveling. You know, I agree. You know, the village needs to be cleaner, absolutely, no doubt. But we can do that and other things.
I'm going to bounce around here a little bit because I have a lot of different opinions. On different subjects. First of all, you know, we're at a distinct disadvantage for jobs here. In order to get more tax dollars into the village of Fredonia, we need jobs. I completely
disagree that the cleanup of the park will bring people in. I just don't think it's going to happen. What brings people in is the ability to draw a living, to feed their family, to live in this area, to put their kids into school. So my advice to the board right now is I would have a full court press on Athenex, because that is our lifeline. If that goes down the drain, there's a 900 jobs, which brings in bigger four people per family, 3,600 people into this area, and they will be living probably closer to Fredonia. To me, that is the most important thing in this village, facing this village today, is a full court press in order to bring these jobs here. As far as the park goes, I think I'm a nuts and bolts, bottom line, I need to see figures. I need to know what the $75,000 looks like in the average person's tax bill. And I think presented that way, it may be a sellable item. If somebody's not afraid of $75,000, and if somebody, let's say the average income, the average assessed house pays an extra $10, $20, $50, I don't know what it would be. I think it would be much more easily sellable in that frame of mind. And I run our business, my wife and I run our business very proactive. If we see a problem, we fix it before it happens. The village of Fredonia right now has deteriorated into an area where there are so many issues that have been ignored for so long. The prior board totally dismissed any type of maintenance on our roads, on the village barns. I mean, people really need to take a walk in the village barns and see what we have there and see what happened. There are so many things coming that we need. Anyway, jobs is what it's going to be about. Jobs, and I really need to see a number. I want to know what it's going to cost me for this park, because I think if that was presented that way, where Matt next to me knew it was going to cost him $25, $50, $100, $200, his portion, you know, I think he would have a different opinion on it.
And Rick is trying to find out that, but it's really not going to cost you, because I won't raise taxes to pay this $45,000, this $100,000.
Well, you know, anytime, I agree, I understand where you're coming from, but anytime somebody delivers goods to my store, I am going to pay the bill on that. I can mix that in with other products, to where, you know, maybe my monthly total is the same as last month, but I'm still paying for it.
We do have to help support
that. I have
that.
To see that go up and be there for a year before I believe it. And I honestly, Jim.
It may not, but if it does, we need to be prepared for that to attract those people to our community. If the community looks terrible, they're gonna walk right on past.
I totally agree.
Always
hungry for more jobs. But they're also going to walk right past, too, if the water lines are breaking and they can't get water to their businesses.
Well, that's
or if the streets can't get plowed because the trucks are broken.
This is correct, and that's another department, that's another aspect of this.
I don't have a problem with the grant. I think we should do some stuff to the park and make it beautiful. My problem is the cost of certain things.
And that's what the mayor was mentioning about the getting different grants.
Some of those things.
This is a grant that... Grants come along from the state and at a certain timing, and if you pass them by, they may not come back again.
Okay,
and those are different departments. Oh, you have your parks department, your water department, your sewage department. These are all different departments, and they're funded in different ways. And so, in order to make this community Fredonia, not the town of Dunkerque with Athenex, but Fredonia, a viable place for people to live, we need to be able to attract businesses. Because business, your growth in businesses will help to defray the cost to the homeowners in your taxes. Okay, that keeps your tax base down, so you're not paying so much for the homeowner. You're developing business.
Jim, I agree with all that.
Right.
I agree with all that. My point is we've heard about Athenex. And I keep bringing this up because really this, we've lost the 400 some jobs at the carriage house. This is a corporation that's, you know, this earmarked to come in here, but I haven't heard a word.
No,
it's like, to me that is very disheartening. And
to me too, but the last time I asked, and it was about 2 weeks ago, they said everything is the way it was. It's coming. At some point they're coming.
I mean, I would put as much pressure as far as the village board as you can on the county government. to get answers.
We hope that it does go through, but once again, we can't base the Village of Fredonia on other communities. You have to base it on what you have here. And the best thing to do is make Fredonia the place that's on everyone's agenda. If they're going to Chautauqua for the week to visit to see performances for the week, it should be on their agenda to come to Fredonia during that week at some point to shop and eat or visit the college. Okay, and that should be from anyone coming through town, and that's, you know, and right now, the way our community appears, I don't see why there would be any reason for them to do that.
I agree with you.
We have to do something.
I agree.
But there needs to be a number for people to be able to digest.
And then I think as us, we as a community, we've got BOCES up the road with conservation programs and masonry, and we've got a college with, my brother's a New York State certified arborist. He can come look at your trees for free, not for 15 grand. I can donate bushes and stuff.
Thank you. This is awesome.
That way you come together instead of spending this kind of money.
Well, that's what she meant. She already mentioned the in-kind services. We're allowed to use a percentage.
That's what I meant. This is an excellent opportunity for the whole community to be part of it, and not only be part of it, be proud of what they did. Be proud of what we did. I mean, there are going to be some people, they're going to be the governor and probably, our senator and our assemblyman, they're going to take pictures, and I'm fine with that. But it's going to be our project. We brought the money, we used the money, it's our money pretty much. We use it to make our community better, and this is going to be the first step. I agree with you, George. Athenex is in my mind 100%. At the same time, other things are in my mind, like we have to expand the downtown. So when somebody comes, has more things to see than five bars and three beauty salons. I'm sorry. this is what I mean. I want people to want to come and visit. I want people to want to come and live here. And we have to give them a reason. Just because I like it, that doesn't mean people will come. And people will come from clean, if the park is clean. But if the park looks better and it's clean at the same time, they're going to come much easier. And maybe they're going to open a cafe there. And maybe they're going to do something more than, you know, pass through and say, okay, there are no branches here, where they're not supposed to be there anyways.
Yes, please. Can I trust Mr. Keefe? I was the trustee, of course. No, there's two that didn't give an answer yet.
Okay, by choice, but I have three concerns on your question there. I'm not
in disagreement with saying we have to fix up our parks. Absolutely. All I had a concern with is I don't know where we stand right now, neither do none of the rest of the trustees. Most of the trustees don't know where we stand as far as costs. I need to have that, like how we had the original grant proposal. I mean, it's changed so much.
The grant proposal has nothing to do now. Now we have the approval.
I understand that. But to, like Mr. Sivlet said, to know where we stand money-wise. Number two, I've been concerned that this is the second major public meeting where people can voice their concerns. I think that I haven't, in a public setting, heard everybody's concerns the way we have tonight. That concerns me. Like from the start, when I was campaigning with the original proposal, many people weren't in favor of that because of the fence and stuff. Now, if that's changed, that's great. My third concern is how you stated that if we don't accept this grant right now, New York State has my arm behind my back and it's holding me hostage from getting any other grants. I really find that discerning, and I don't appreciate
I did talk to a representative from the governor's office recently, and this representative said, you know, it would really be a negative impact to the governor if Fredonia turned their back on this grant.
The credibility of the village is going to be.
And, you know,
I understand that.
About that, you know, there's a lot of work that went into this grant. Part of what's happening with this grant is based on a property tax cap that was put on our taxes. You know, we capped our budgets for the last how many years, Rick?
Are you on a five now?
Yeah. 5 years. We've had a cap on our taxes. The governor said that he would reward communities that stayed under their cap
with grant money, and that's what this grant money is. This is kind of a payback. And to say, no, we don't want your money now, would be, you know, a slap.
Well, I absolutely agree, but without knowledge of what it's going to cost, without public input, I can't make an educated decision on this, because it's based on economics and what the grant is proposed and what it's cost, and plus what my constituents voice as their concerns or they're in favor of it. I mean,
and what I would do is I'd refer you right back to what Mark Twitchell said a while ago. I think he had a clear, concise message of exactly what's involved with this. Things that need to be done anyway, things that, you know, the fountains need to be rearranged. The bricks around the fountains are starting to sink in. The recycling pump would make all the difference in the world. Why waste water just flowing it through there on a daily basis when you could recycle the water and reuse it? The sidewalks, they are crumbling. You know, do you have to replace every one of them? If you want a nice, consistent look, it's better to replace them all. You know, that's not a call for somebody like me to make, but, you know, that's a call that needs to be made. The lighting systems, if you can get more efficient fuel, you know, lights,
yeah,
that
LED
pays back over the years. You know, and all this could be done on 25 cents on the dollar.
I understand the percentage there. I just need to know what the costs are so I can make an educated. I want the bottom, yeah, like Mr. Sillette said, we need to know the bottom line. It's anywhere from $59,000 to $102,000 is the big bottom line.
That's the bottom line.
That's the bottom line.
And there's the next step.
Is that what it's going to be, 59?
The next step in the process is to now send this forward and then get the return on it so that we can then we can adopt it.
Listen, I don't, you know, between $59,000 and $100,000, call it $75,000. Call it $75,000 and come up with a number that it's going to cost every taxpayer, because quite honestly, if you do get 75 cents on a dollar from the state of New York to fix this park and update it to 2018, you do it.
Right.
But it has to make sense financially to everybody. And I think if it's broken down to where a taxpayer knows exactly what it's going to take out of their own personal budget, you know, it's a lot easier sell, I think.
So.
It's 92 cents per thousand taxable assessed on your property. So a $100,000 home, you would pay about $18.50. Because the taxable assessed on $100,000, the taxable assessed on $100,000 home would be about
$18.
Per household, yes.
Yeah, the amount.
How much is the project then? Is that the full $400,000?
No, that's just our portion. That's using Mr. Sivilla's.
Using
his $75,000 number.
The thing that I would like to know.
Just a frame of reference for everybody in the room. For every dollar of tax, every dollar of taxes raised gets the village $81,000.
So for every dollar
so
that
every
we pay,
dollar tax increase gives you $81,000 to the
per thousand,
village coffers.
I'd like to know, maybe this question should come to you, but how the grant will actually work. So you mentioned earlier that it would be bonded. So that means that the state is giving us $400,000, but we bonded up front.
No. Yes. Yeah. Yes. We bonded up front, yes.
But the state is giving us this money, but we bonded up front, and then we get all the money back the day that the project is done, or is it over years, or how does that work?
What you would do in
and,
that case
me,
is
and
you float.
How does the interest work in that? Then?
You actually float a bond, which is called a bond anticipation note, for a year, okay, while the project is going on, and you're distributing the money, but it's called a callable bond. So as soon as we get reimbursed from the state, we take out the bond. We just pay off the principal on that bond.
And then
so whatever period you've taken that loan out for is the only period you're gonna pay interest. So if it's a 9 month period, you'll pay 9 months worth of interest. Just have to make sure the bond is callable.
Okay, and then how does the administrator, because you had mentioned that there would be an administrator for this.
Grant.
Yeah,
yes.
How would that fit in the total picture? Is that part of the 400,000?
It was originally, but now the county is doing it, and it costs us nothing.
And that, again, like the mayor's saying, that could go toward in-kind. And to answer Doug's question, it's hard to say exactly what it's going to cost the residents, because like the gentleman in the back said that his brother is an arborist, that may be able to do the arborist thing in the park. So that takes that and moves it off to the side.
So instead
that,
of
that goes toward the village's hundred and something thousand toward our thing. You know, the, you know, these different things, the electrician that the mayor mentioned, that's going to go toward our in-kind. You know, if the street department takes out the sidewalks, that'll go toward in-kind. All that stuff will go, but
The more of that happens, the closer we get to that $59,000 right. minimum that we have to come up with.
But we don't
so that can reduce it down to
the $59,000, so everybody understands, the $59,000 we have to pay. Mm-hmm. In cash, that's it. We do have to pay for that.
Pardon, Barrett, now.
Yes, I'm sorry.
The other component of this is maintenance.
I mean, that has to be figured into, because the difference in maintenance from what we have now to what we're going to have. I can tell you right now, obviously, if you close off and make it a closed system for the fountains, it's going to require chemicals. Yeah. I think the taxpayers are good before a real decision can be obtained by a taxpayer, some type of forecasting for maintenance has to be involved with this too, a yearly maintenance difference on what it would be. I can't see it being a whole lot, but I think it would be pretty.
That's a good question, George. And you know, in this community, the argument for so long about running the water continuously through the fountains, which by the way totals to hundreds of thousands of gallons per year. The payback period on that was we figured once 20 years with pumps, chemicals, maintenance, all of that. But now we're looking at huge infrastructure water projects that are going to increase our water rates by three times. Suddenly, the cost of water is going to approach a value
nothing
where
comes.
We are not going to be comfortable walking past these fountains and knowing that it's just flowing down the drain.
Just that one fix alone.
Can I ask a simple question? You said we don't have the manpower or whatever to pick up sticks during the day, so what personnel is going to be going over testing the water on a daily basis and doing that?
It's not going to test the water on a daily basis. I mean, nobody does that.
Really?
But, you know, of course, we're going to need some taking care of. But if we start from who's going to take care of that, we're never going to fix anything. This is why you're here. This is why we're all here. We're all here so we can figure out these things. And it's a good thing that you thought of that, because as we go forward, we're going to put it inside the maintenance. And I mean, that's the same thing. You're not going to buy a new refrigerator because who's going to clean it? Of course you're going to buy a new refrigerator bigger than the one before, and you're going to have some extra time to clean it. This is how these things happen. We cannot stop because of that. And I want to address something else before, but that you said before. This is maybe the biggest crowd that we ever had. However, this has been out there for months. For a year, more than a year. We had 5 open meetings. And the open meetings is not exactly that. They're open. Everybody can come. Everybody can say anything. We have actually, it's the workshop and the meeting. And as you know, both of them have public portion. I never stopped anybody for saying anything about any subject at any of our meetings. Once a month, I have coffee with the mayor, the first Wednesday of every month, from 9 o'clock to sometimes goes to 12 o'clock. Anybody can come. No agenda, no questions that I asked before. They come in, they sit down on the chair, we can talk. Everybody knew about all these things. I go to the radio once a month. I discuss everything on the radio. There is no question that I don't answer unless I don't know, so I say I don't know, of course. So. The opportunity was out there. Okay. And to be honest with you, well, how many people are here? Like 25, 30 people? 10,000 people don't still out there. And they can say tomorrow morning that nobody told me anything about it.
Well, first of all, I appreciate you allowing us to have this special meeting. As on our regular, you say people can come to a regular board meeting. As you see our regular board meetings, how many people do we have show up? Usually none.
Please so, come to every board meeting, please
this is
do.
What, thankfully we had this, so we did have some more public input. This is the most public input that I've seen.
And I have a lot of letters. I have to say that people sent some letters.
Those would be interesting to see as well. I mean,
but it's not for the lack of ability for them to come. That's what I have to say, Doug. This was put in a special meeting, but there's not for the lack of ability. Our meetings are always open. I don't know.
Now that's what I meant.
Exactly what
well,
she
yes,
said.
Yes, I understand that.
It's not for the lack of ability for people to participate. There is not. This is the most transparent board that I could that I've ever seen in Fredonia, as far as being open and transparent, and the ability for people to come and requested to come. And like you said, yes, it's most often there's very few people here. But that's not because they don't.
Or nobody.
Yeah, that's my point.
It's not for the
we're not getting the input on a regular public meeting, on a regular general board.
Well, maybe this is a good opportunity for all of you to see how nice we are here.
It is nice.
We have such a good time. And we meet three times, three Mondays, not the first Monday, but we meet the second Monday, the third Monday, and the fourth Monday of every month. From 6:30, usually to 8:30. Please stop by. We would love to have your opinion. And please, so many people didn't speak today. Can you tell me what your opinion is? This nice lady here.
Sorry, I didn't hear what you said.
Can you tell us what your opinion is?
Well, I was just thinking back a few years ago when Fredonia had attractions for people to come here, because we happened to be in Chautauqua for a few days and talked to people, and they were not around the area at all, but they loved to come every year to the White Inn, the Tower Gifts, the gift shop on White Street, the gift shop behind White Street, and there were, you have to have something to go to. I mean, the park is, I'm for doing things to the park. I really didn't favor the fence, but it does need some work, certainly. But I felt that, I feel there's nothing here for anybody to want to come to Fredonia.
I agree.
You're not going to come 100%. Just to get a cup of coffee at one of the delis or whatever, but I don't know how you do that.
Well,
or
there is not a magic wand that nobody can, you know, wave around and do that. However, first of all, and this is what I'm trying to do, we have to put Fredonia on the map so people know we are here. We are a small community, not very small, but small. So we have to put it out there. We're open for business. Stop by because we have the Opera House. Stop by because we have a beautiful park. Stop by because we have this very cool little store and we can have coffee there. Stop by because we have a nice bookstore.
Also, a few years ago, I did a calendar of Fredonia, all drawn pictures of the Victorian things of Fredonia. And, well, there's the gas well and the WCA and the Grange with First Grange of the country. There were little things, and I tried to bring all these things out in there, but of course that isn't, those things aren't anything that are going to draw people, but it's an interesting thing what you can bring out when you're advertising Fredonia.
Absolutely. We have so many firsts in Fredonia. Fredonia is first in many, many things, like the Grange, as you said, and the first seed company actually started from the back of my house. Funny enough, and the first gas well we have there, and the Cushing brothers, and Mark Twain. We have so many really treasures here. I just want to take them out and show people what we have. But it's not going to happen from one moment to the next, and we can't afford to do it by ourselves. That's why I'm trying to be noticed by the governor. I'm trying to have the governor know that we're doing something here. And we need help. And I have to tell you, at the last State of the State address, we went with some of the trustees, and the governor said that there are 16 municipalities in the state of New York that are eligible for downtown revitalization grant. 500,000, not a lot, not a huge amount, 500,000. While one of the 16 is Fredonia. It's out there. You saw it. It was on,
on the screen.
On the screen.
Hundreds of people saw it.
Yep.
So I'm not saying that we are, you know, doing everything and anything we can. We're just trying to make some small steps to the right direction. And at the same time, we need to fix infrastructure. That's my main problem. Infrastructure needs to be fixed. To bring new businesses, big businesses, they need to know that we have water, we have sewer, and they're working fine.
Parking is sometimes a problem, too.
Oh, the parking lots are the problem. Yes, don't start me with that one. That was, that's a big problem. Absolutely.
And add it to the list.
We have big, nice parking lots. They're just not fixed. I mean, you go there and they're full of potholes and the lighting is not enough. Yes, we can fix all that. And guess what? I'm going to start asking for money for that too. They're going to get tired of me asking for money, hopefully. And then they're going to give me the money and get away with it.
I remember when
yes.
Well,
that was quite a few years ago.
Yeah.
If you don't recognize me, I'm going to do it in the end of the
show. Oh, okay. Thank you. That's so nice. Thank you.
My wife is a little kinder than I am, so she's given me some space to be a little meaner.
Okay.
But not that mean.
All right.
I'm going to make a few remarks that are historical in the 60s when I was on the board. At that time, Dunkirk was getting into urban renewal. And one of the mandates of the state or the federal government was they had to do a regional study of the area.
Mm-hmm.
Dunkirk, Fredonia, went as far as Silver Creek. I don't know how far past Brockton. And if it got as far as Stockton.
Right.
But anyway, we hired first they formed the regional planning board, and I was a charter member of that board. We hired an engineering firm. They did the study. The results come back that Dunkirk was going to be the industrial area of the region because of the access to railroads, the lake, water to drink, water for commercial use, shipping, access to the highway. The rest of the region was going to be the residential area.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the problem with the village. We have a residential tax base that doesn't provide enough over and above maintenance funds for big projects. Mm-hmm. I remember Sandro Sr., who was village attorney when I was on the board. The trustees would come in, off elections, and they're all excited. They want to do this, want to do that. And Sam was the old timer. He was a perennial fixture on the board. Trustees came and went. He had two jobs that Sam, Mr. Fair did first. He'd teach the trustees a little bit about village law, and he'd always tell them, listen, the village doesn't have any money, go easy on the spending. And he was so right. Today, we're worse off than we were earlier. In the early days, we had canning companies, we had Mitchell Foods,
mm-hmm.
a lot of seed companies. We have nothing. We just lost our last canning company.
Mm-hmm.
A few years back, we lost our last seed company. We have to prioritize our projects. I don't want to be negative. And we've got a lot of projects that I understand are going to come up. The reservoir, one way or another, is going to cost millions of dollars. I would have been against 100% of this. Now, this little project, I could kind of agree with my wife.
Okay. Thank you, that's good.
The village has to go slow on spending money. And that's the message I'd like to hear tonight.
I have to tell you that I just finished my budget, and the increase in the budget that I put in is less than the inflation rate. So I don't think they can do any better than that. We're below the inflation. This is, I think this is something good.
Brings up another point, Ben. We've reached a point, we have nothing else to tax. Our, my tax, because I live up there in Castle Heights, in one of those condos, and the market value of my place is $98,000. It's public record, so I can talk about it. My village tax is $680. My water bill for the year is $630.
Yeah.
When my water bill is equivalent to my tax bill, we're in trouble. We have to look for other areas of getting money. I think it's about time that we ask the state to pay a lump sum to the village in lieu of taxes. Otherwise, we're in trouble.
I agree.
We need other.
I agree with that. We should make contact with her.
State representative, and move immediately on this issue.
We're the third largest community in the county. We pay about the village spends about $900 per capita in the village, which is about half of what the next two larger communities in the county spend. So when you talk about how much we spend, I think the village does an extremely good job of spending your dollars, being at half of what the next two similar sized communities spend. Okay. With that being said, you are correct, sir, as far as knowing that there is a very big disparity of how the state spends their dollars in communities. Fredonia should be getting a much larger portion of your state tax dollars. We don't.
For example, I have to say something now. We are about the same size as Dunkirk, about the same size, very small difference. We're about the same size area-wise as Dunkirk, as you know. We have 14 police officers, they have 36. We have 9 paid firefighters, they have 25. They get from the state $1,600,000 a year. You know very well how much we get. 97,000.
That's it.
That's it. So you are very correct. We the help from the state is minimal. And if I can do something, I will. Because this is going on between all mayors. Everybody's talking about it. Not that anybody's listening, but at least we're talking about it. Yes, we. So the point is that at this moment, we just have to beg for money. We just have to go there and ask for our money, and we have to prove to them that we're going to use it in a good way.
Sure.
For the time being, this is the reality.
Well, we want to make sure that we don't leave the impression to the university that they're not welcome here. We certainly appreciate the university.
Absolutely.
It's a terrific asset to this area. It brings in spending money, but it doesn't help our tax base.
There's another area that also is the sales tax. It is not distributed in an equitable fashion. The village gets a much smaller portion of the sales tax that's collected within this county. The portion goes to the state and the rest gets distributed to the county, but it's not an equitable split. There are communities that get a very, very high percentage compared to Fredonia, or even some of the other communities that get a very small percentage. That is another area that should be looked at. But these are reasons why your taxes are so high. It's not because this village is not an efficient governing body. We have a very low cost per capita of spending comparatively for the rest of when you compare it to the rest of the county.
Yeah, we can't complain about the village tax or the water bill. They're both, and we have no other course. We have to accept it. There's no other way to get money.
Well, the other way to get money is ask for grants. At this point, we have to work with what we have.
That's right.
And this is what we're talking about when the mayor said that we're going after as many grants as we can because we're trying to work within the system until it changes.
But I don't know how the village would, if you'd have gone ahead with that big water expansion deal, I don't know how financially the village could have handled it. There's just not the tax base to support this village to support a project like that.
The answer is very, very simple. We can't afford the alternative. You know, the answer is simple. We cannot afford the alternative. Yesterday, the paper said I'm raising the water rate 27%. Actually, I'm raising it 30%. If we go with the North County Water District, it's going to be raised 246%. So we have to do it ourselves. There is no other way.
One last thing. What really compelled me here tonight is there was an article, the editor in Dunkirk wrote an article a couple of weeks ago, and he kind of looked down on the village and said we were too negative. Well, he's got to understand we don't have the money to be positive,
We are very positive here. And also,
that's the message I give to all you people tonight.
We're very positive here. Positive.
Getting the grant was good news. That's a positive thing for the village.
I mean, I went there and I thought they were making fun of me when I said, did we get some money? And the mayor of Jamestown, who got a lot of money, by the way, he was looking and he said, yeah, you got $325. I said, $325? No, $325,000. So, and I couldn't believe it. I went from one to the other to the other. I was in Albany checking that actually got this money. And I want to say something about the university. The president of the university is the one who went to the Regional Economic Development Council. She presented in a way that it was put on a top priority, and she was part of the reason that we got this money. And now, more good news, she is the co-chair of the Regional Economic Development Council from this year on. So, and she lives in Fredonia, that's good. She's here. So I really want to thank her from the bottom of my heart for that help. Yes, please.
Sort of to get back to the grant, mm-hmm. I want to say, first of all, I personally think it's a very wise move to take advantage of the money that the state is willing to provide us. But then I have a procedural question. So what happens next? Does this come to a vote by the trustees? Are you going to be making a final decision on this soon?
Yes. Well, it's going to come to a vote, but not at this moment. I have to send, as I said, the budget in, and then the administrator of the grant has to submit a whole number of papers. After the state has all that, it's going to send to us a contract. And at that point, the trustees have to vote to accept the contract or not. And if they do accept the contract, then we go out to bids to see who's going to do the whole project. And from that point on, we proceed.
So that could happen like what, later in the summer? Would probably be as early as
Yes. I'm hoping it's going to happen by June, actually. The vote, June, July. But I don't see the project going on this summer. We are kind of late.
And the fact that we've delayed, is that going to affect the anything in regards to the grant?
I don't think so, because they made some phone calls and they assured me that it would not. So I have to take them at their word.
Mayor, the estimates that you have, the estimates that you have proposed, mm-hmm. where did those come from? Did you get some preliminary bids?
Yes, I did not a bid, because I couldn't pay for a bid, but I got some estimates from an actual firm. Yes.
Okay.
And I'm not going to say that we're going to go with that firm.
Do you feel they're consistent to what may come in? Because the bids that come in may be completely different. There may be a lot more.
Well, they're going to be one of the people who are going to bid on that. They assured me. So if they are the lowest bid, they got the job. These are the numbers I have. I can give you the very easily. I can give it to you. But these are the first professional numbers that I actually have.
Okay. And the board at some point could nail down a number for what it's going to cost each taxpayer per thousand, I'm assuming, before the vote?
Yes. Well, yeah. Rick just said 90 cents per thousand of assessed.
Well, I mean, when you have the actual numbers.
Oh, yes, yeah. Yes. This is only based on the 75,000 that we might. Now, right. I would, you know, invite everybody, if you have any ideas as to how to collect some money, how to fundraise for this, this is the time, you know, from a dollar to $50,000. We're open to everything. We're accepting everything. Yes, sir.
I talked to you one time about setting up a GoFundMe account, mm-hmm. and you can open it up to, you know, on the internet to people that have lived in Fredonia, maybe gone to Fredonia State, something a little more progressive. I don't think anybody in this room is opposed to sprucing up the parks. Mm-hmm. It's a matter of, are you listening to what the people want? And when they didn't want the fence, it came out, but that's because the budget was wrong. Am I right?
You, listen, when I started, I didn't know that the number was wrong. When I got the money. So that's why I wanted to put the two committees together.
Right.
I said, I want 30 people of the community.
Right.
If these 30 people tell me that they don't want the fence, I'm going to find a way to take
right.
it out.
So now you're listening, and now we'll be able to go forward with maybe something. I don't know if they're going to vote on it, yes or no, but there is some amount of community so that you have the input.
I have the input of, you know.
Right, today. Yes. We have it today.
Yes.
Also
feel free to stop by the office. I'm here every day. Feel free to send a letter. Feel free to come for a coffee. We have very good coffee every first Wednesday. Please
think
do.
Think about a GoFundMe account because it reaches outside of our community. It doesn't come from our community coffers.
That's great.
Everybody that's having a hard time paying taxes or water bills, GoFundMe might come from somebody that graduated from Fredonia State that has $1 billion.
That's a good idea.
That would be nice.
I do know that all the bricks between the curb and the street, they're a mess. They need to be replaced. What
yes.
about some kind of brick drop? They're only $3 to $5 a piece in that roughly in that area. Mm-hmm. Everybody in town buys a brick. You can have somebody's name put on it and then put it, and that way that can be ripped
absolutely.
And redone.
Absolutely, yes. That's one possibility as well. You know, that's the more people get involved, the more ideas we're going to have.
Well, that's nice because it takes ownership of your community that way, and it shows a lot more pride in your community. And it's nice that you actually offered about, you know, the arborist and stuff like that, because the more community, the people that are actually involved in doing the project, the more pride they have, and the less the garbage gets put around, and the more it's taken care of. But the pride itself means a lot. Because then they tell people how wonderful the community is. So that's a very good idea.
Mind one even considering making the sidewalks brick and having, because that's a lot more attractive.
At least maybe around the fountains, or actually the other side where all the trees by the gazebo, because it's so shaded you can't grow
that's
anything anyways.
That's a good idea. We need something that
yes.
has been for years.
A lot of good ideas.
Talk about the taxpayers having to pay the initial financing on Friday. Can organizations help defer that cost by donating time to do parts of the project?
Yes.
Like, whether it's college, Cub Scouts, sports teams,
sports
local contractors that want to help and do some work? Is that
absolutely.
Going to help defer some of the, if we knew the scope of work or if the organizations knew the scope of work, would that help?
Absolutely.
I'm sure everybody wants to see one more beautified. You know, I've spoken with a couple that, you know, donating some time would definitely help out. Helping taxpayers and, you know.
Absolutely. We appreciate every help. Yes, of course. The reason that I didn't put more in kind was because I was only thinking about DPW and I didn't want to put any burden on them. So I put the whole amount as actual money. But we have this opportunity to actually donate time. That would be great.
And didn't years ago the police department do something with some of the
not so desirable children on the weekend. They have
you don't have any of those in Fredonia,
pick up garbage
do
around the village.
I was thinking about that, actually.
I thought we only had desirables here.
I was never part of it.
But I have another idea that doesn't really pertain to the park, but it pertains to bringing people in.
Okay.
Especially in winter. We've got a football field that barely gets used anymore. Why can't we turn it into ice skating rinks in the winter? A sledding hill?
Absolutely.
Why don't we do that?
We can. But, you know, Sarah, this is the problem. All of these are good ideas that need money.
And people to organize them.
And people to organize it. I would love for everybody to get involved and bring their ideas and then take us to the next step. Because ideas are good, but we have to go to the next step. And be here at the next meeting. And be here, you know, when, instead of going home and having a nice dinner, be here. that's the truth. You know, Monday morning, I understand that people have to go home. But I appreciate the fact that instead you come here to give us your ideas and your input.
My final comment is about the high water rate. It might be a good thing. In biblical days, they drank wine because water. 2,000 years later, we might have to drink water because it's too expensive.
More wine, less water. I like that. That's we sell t-shirts. Less water.
And with that, I'm going home.
Thank you. Anybody else? Yes.
One thing, no names mentioned, but I have talked to people in garden clubs, and they've gotten very negative responses to work they've wanted to do. And I think that the village has to be more open to garden clubs doing things.
Absolutely.
I agree.
You know, sometimes what happens, people come and offer, you know, their work. But as you know, we're very understaffed in this building. I am my own secretary, I am my own everything. Sometimes you can come and give me, you know, offer something, and I forget it. I have to, you know, I have to say that. They did come. Sometimes I forget to give a call back, or I don't have time for that.
I don't want anybody
to take it personally. Please come back. You know, even better, send me an email, so the email is always there, and I go back and check it. The email is easier, you know, than a phone call. But I appreciate both, and I do. Yes.
I just want to say I couldn't support this project anymore. It's great. I love it. I live here now. I have a house. But I grew up in Hamburg,
mm-hmm.
and it was the exact same situation we're at now, where mm-hmm. when I was growing up, it was, you know, let's say 15 years ago, a third of the storefronts were empty. It's like Rick said, there was no reason to go there other than the post office or the, you know, the bank. And then they put some money toward making the village a more desirable place to go, and, you know, business after business opened. And
Hamburg is great.
It's
lovely, and there's so many more businesses and restaurants. And
I came back after I...
a lot of jobs in that area, though.
Yeah, that's true, absolutely.
Oh, sure.
No doubt.
Sure, but... You know, I came back after college. It was a totally different town. It was crazy.
Yeah.
They could not keep a business open there before, you know.
And now you have find a space to put a new business there.
Yeah, exactly.
That's and that's a great example of a place that actually can turn the other way and start development financially. And that's where we are. This is what we want. I mean, what are the reasons is out there?
Yeah.
Anybody else?
Some of the concerns from people, and the young lady in the back started to talk about it, is the maintenance. Now this is, I've had a lot of people ask me about it. I brought it up at the beginning of this whole thing. And I didn't quite understand the answer when she was asking about it. If we're not able to maintain things right now, and we put flower beds and do all kinds of stuff to the park, that's a concern from people. If there are people that volunteer to do whatever, pull weeds or whatever. And I think Steve went through this when he was watering plants, that there could possibly be a grievance from the DPW. So we have to be careful in that aspect that people are gonna volunteer, because that could be a wall we come up against.
It'd be great if people could volunteer.
I don't think.
Plants every year.
But I'm talking about certain things, not just plant flowers, not water. I'm talking about certain specific things.
Certain labor things. And you're right.
Throw off.
Rick would like to address that?
Yeah, no, that, you know, for volunteers, they can't grieve that because it's not something that the village is doing, that, you know, like internally to avert their work. It's actually people coming in and taking pride in their community, so they wouldn't grieve that. That wouldn't be agreeable. Anybody that's ever come and volunteered their labor or volunteered their, you know, I know the flowers and stuff like that, that they come here and plant, they would never grieve that.
Now, let's say across the street in front of the old Murphy's building, when the state went through, I think 16 years ago maybe, and they did the brickwork between the curb and the sidewalks.
20 years
now
ago.
That is, was it 20?
Yeah, 20 at least. Babies.
I mean, that's a huge liability for us right now. Where's the state helping with that? We don't have the manpower to fix that, yet we're responsible for it. Where are they? I can understand them wanting to give money for that. It's great. And I bet you there's a lot of people in this room are going to start raising money for this. And if it's only $18 per household, it's not a big deal. But then the maintenance down the road. There also is the fact that, and I think I heard correctly from a couple different people, we put the money up front first, and then it gets approved, correct? How long could this, what'd you say, a year this could drag out? It's up, it's a bond type issue?
Yeah, I mean, you would, again, take out a bond anticipation note. Those are usually 1 year in duration. I mean, if it took longer than a year, you would just renew that bond anticipation note and make it callable so that whenever the project was complete, it's approved, the state starts reimbursing, you take out the loan.
Now, I don't know. There's been cases out there where they haven't approved it. I'm just throwing it out there that it could be a possibility.
Yeah, I don't know that.
As far as the reservoir, just to touch on that, I believe there's a bill in Congress that we could get a lot of funding for that. Because it's a high hazard dam.
Right.
So before we go jumping into anything with that, or a water district, anything, I think we need to know if there's some money that's going to come from them. And by the sounds of it, big money.
But that can take years. And our dam cannot wait.
Well, the engineers that we've hired, part of their task is to go and search out all grant opportunities that are available to the village. They were the ones that pointed those grants out. Yeah. So that's part of their...
So we're hoping for that.
Yeah.
I think Mark brings up a good point for the design of the sidewalk areas being done. It really needs to be done for safety, more than aesthetics.
Yeah.
Because you turn on the new news, it's one attorney after another advertising to sue you.
Yeah.
And, you know, who's more, you know, open to be sued than the municipality. So
well, I'm talking about what was done by the state.
Right.
And
right, but I'm saying even
now it's in our
papers, if this project does go, I agree. Even though they're beautiful, it's a hazard. People trip and fall.
But people,
there's a liability.
When they, the way they are now, it's much more possible for somebody to trip and fall.
Yeah.
If we fix them, they're going to be, it's going to be, that's the point of being more safe as we walk there. And I'm hoping for that because especially two sides that I walked very recently are really in bad condition.
Rick
like
moves, Rick needs maintenance. And even if you redo it, in 10 or 15 years, time, we have to do it again.
And that's the point. The point is that whatever we do from now on, I'm going to propose this board to have a schedule of maintenance. Because otherwise, you wait for the next 15 years, and what do you find yourself? You have to do it all over again. Another big expense.
The landscape architect engineer that we came and spoke with, he actually said the brickwork can actually be cost savings in the long run because you could reset the brick as opposed to pulling it out and having completely replace it when it starts to crack because of our winters and things. So they're I mean, we look at some things that are 20 years old, and we say, well, no maintenance has been done for 20 years. Oh my gosh, there's a problem. Somebody needs to come and replace or fix it. Well, yeah, they do. Somebody needs to do it. We need to do it. This is our community, and we need to take care of it. You can't expect it to last, you know, it doesn't matter if it's brick, pavement, or concrete, 20 years goes by, things happen, it needs to be addressed.
That brings up another point.
There's maintenance.
It brings up another point that I've heard from business people. So east and west parking lots, with the mm-hmm. existing businesses there now, mm-hmm. they're asking, you know, what's going on? And now, I mean, I understand you think this will bring in businesses, but the ones that are here now, with what's going on in the parking lot, they're having...
Well, that's going to be another project, because you can't afford it.
That's another project. That's another project.
We're not able to maintain and do what we have.
Well, there's many areas of the village that need to be maintained, and you have to start somewhere. You can't just throw your hands up and say, well, everything looks bad, and then say, well, I guess we're just not going to do anything. You have to start at the point...
Just a simple thing, like the young lady in the back was talking about, picking up sticks and whatnot. Yeah, you do have to start somewhere. We're not going to have, I mean, you do this project, and I brought it up at the beginning, it's going to be a maintenance
picking up stick,
nightmare.
Picking up sticks is
not...
Nobody's against picking up the sticks. I mean, but this is, I mean, you have to start somewhere. Something has to be done. This is unacceptable to do nothing. I mean, we could disagree. You know, it's okay to disagree. It's fine. I don't care. You know, that's. I mean, I do care, but.
Well, again, to go back, we have this opportunity to use money that is ours, but is not here, and it's given to us now to use to beautify our community. I understand if it was my choice, I was going to take this $400,000 and put it towards an infrastructure project first. But this is like a gift card. It's a gift card from the Parks Department of the State of New York. And it's a good thing because, well, regularly they give 50%, you pay 50%. We have a high poverty level in our community. That's why they give us 75%. That was one of the other reasons I chose this project first. Because if you go to Department of Transportation, they only pay 20%. You have to come up with 80%. We were not able to come with that. So I think this is something central. This is something that connects us to Dunkirk and the area. It's regionalism in its best, in my opinion, because it's going to bring some people. And hopefully, this is the first step for better and more projects to come our way. I certainly won't stop trying. I invite all of you to be with me and start trying and put a plan together to go and fix our villas and bring some new businesses. If you know anybody who is thinking of opening up a business, let's start talking. We have empty front stores here. We have to fill them up. We have a community, a young community, young people here. We have to keep them here. If we can, every year, we can keep some of these students to open up a business and have a family here, we're gonna double our size before we know it. And this is the secret. The secret is bringing new people, more people to our area. Because we won't raise taxes. We can't do that. I think we taxed to the maximum. We all did. Now we have to find another way to bring some money so we can start, like to fix our house so we can have more people to come and buy from our house, have more people to come and live in our house. Yes?
So if the grant gets approved, pact that we're going to get local vendors, local people to do this work, to do the bids.
We're going to give them preference.
To the extent possible.
But there is,
because our community could use the local.
Yeah.
We have to go to bids.
There's requirements for bidding. Yeah. There's closed bids.
Right. Three bids for a state requirement.
Men and
women, veterans,
women and minority businesses.
Right.
All of those, there's certain percentages of the project that have to be completed by those. So there's a lot of things. You can't give preference to anybody.
Right.
They have the right to bid on the project. That's what they do. When
they
open the bids, as long as they meet the minimum qualifications, they can be awarded the bid. So
there's a lot of local businesses that are on the fringe.
But I was going to say, if I remember it, we are allowed to utilize, just as they said, if we have some volunteers or within it. So we really need to utilize that.
If it is volunteer job, volunteer work, then we don't have to go to bids. Like if there is somebody from the community who's going to come and say, I'll do the whole project. I use my company and I don't want anything. We have to go nowhere. Volunteer and free work we take. But if the actual project has to go to bids. Anything else?
I'd just like to thank all of you folks for coming. This was a nice turnout, mm-hmm. and it Very was good. Nice to get some feedback. And I think that was really important, at least for me, to hear it. I hear a lot of things out in the community, but I got different input now. So thank you. I appreciate you coming.
Thank you very much. Thank you. And please remember, three times a month, Mondays a month we're here.